Hello everyone, today I am going to discuss with you all regarding the 15 questions and answers on the topic intensive care unit in the question and answer format. Let's see the first one. What is mechanical ventilation? So mechanical ventilation is a method to mechanically assist or replace the spontaneous breathing, and it can be done with a machine called a ventilator. Now ventilator you must have seen in the intensive care unit, it is having so many different modes. And based on the clinical findings and the need of the patient, different modes on the ventilator can be set. And previously we have seen the Servo 900 most commonly used the ventilator, but nowadays n number of companies are manufacturing the ventilators. So this mechanical ventilators are the machines that generate a controlled flow of gas into the patient's airway, which is delivered to the patient using one of the many available modes of ventilator. And the primary indication for this mechanical ventilation is existing respiratory failure. So the role which we play when the patient is on the ventilator is the physiotherapy is helpful for weaning the patient from the ventilator. Let's see the second one. What is CPAP? That is continuous positive airway pressure. So in this, the positive pressure is applied throughout the respiratory cycle to the spontaneously breathing patient, and the patient must have a reliable ventilation drive and the adequate tidal volume. Now why, when the CPAP machine can be used, the indications are adequate ventilation is present, but that means amount of air going in and out of the lung is present, that is adequate, but there is incompetent oxygenation. And it is seen in the conditions like atelectasis and when there is a retention of the secretions. Second, need to wean the patient and promote the alveolar stability and to improve the functional residual capacity. And third one, it is used nowadays in the obstructive sleep apnea patient. See the third one. What is the weaning off from the ventilator? This is one of the main role of the chest physiotherapist in the intensive care unit. It is a process of withdrawing the patient from the mechanical ventilatory support in a staged manner. Okay, remember this important term, staged manner, that means step by step. The patient who required ventilation for a short term do not require extensive weaning program. For example, the patient who have post-operative because of the effects of general anesthesia, they have kept on the ventilator. So here the lengthy extensive weaning program is not needed. Only for the short term they will be kept on the ventilator. True weaning is required in patient in whom the respiratory muscles are weak and detrained. So we need to strengthen those muscles, we need to facilitate those muscles, etc. So the goal of the weaning program is to facilitate, and the endurance of the respiratory muscle needs to be improved for the sustained spontaneous ventilation. This is the main role performed by the chest physiotherapist. What is intubation? Okay. Intubation is an emergency procedure most often performed in patients who are unconscious or who cannot breathe on their own. So what happens through this intubation, an endotracheal or the tracheostomy tube can be inserted into the patient's respiratory tract. So it provides a provision of a closed system for the initiation of the mechanical ventilation. And second, it helps to provide the artificial ventilation. That means you can connect the patient later on, once you are doing the intubation, you can connect the patient with the endotracheal or tracheostomy tube. After the placing it, you can connect with the ventilator. So then, which is used to get air in and out of the lungs. And it can also be used for the prevention of aspiration when upper airway protective reflexes are inadequate. So these are the uses, and this is what the intubation is. Let's see what is suctioning. So one of the most commonly performed technique in the intensive care unit is the suctioning. It is a procedure of applying the negative pressure, that means vacuum, to the airways through a collecting tube. And this pressure will help in the removal of the mucus and secretions from the trachea, and used in the individual who lack the ability to cough. So when the secretions are present in the say upper part of just above the carina, say in the trachea, the secretions are present, but through the coughing and huffing you are not able to remove it, So you can think of doing the suctioning. Here is one mnemonic you have to remember, that is SON, S-O-N. So this is the mode of doing the suctioning. S means suction via tube. You can do the suctioning via endotracheal tube or tracheostomic tube. O means oropharyngeal, through the mouth you can do the suctioning. And N means nasopharyngeal, so through the nose also you can do the suctioning. Sixth one, what is oxygen therapy? So oxygen is a colorless, odorless and tasteless gas that is essential for the body to function properly and to survive. The air that we breathe in, it contains approximately 21% of oxygen. Therefore, supplemental oxygen administration is delivery of any oxygen concentration that is greater than 21%. And oxygen is a gas, but when administered as a supplement to the normal atmospheric air, it may also be considered as a medication or the drug. So there are high flow oxygen delivery system and there is low flow oxygen delivery system. So in the low flow oxygen delivery system, you must have seen the oxygen is delivered through the face masks, oxygen is delivered through the nasal bipronx. Let's see the next one. What is pulse oximeter? Nowadays you can find pulse oximeter in almost every home. So it is basically continuous and non-invasive measurement of the arterial oxygen saturation, SaO2, which is the amount of oxygen carried by the hemoglobin. And when it is measured by the device called pulse oximeter, the abbreviation used is SpO2. And it is measured by keeping the probe on the finger, earlobe or other transparent body parts in which the pulsating arterial bed can be detected. So continuous monitoring of the oxygen saturation is being done in the intensive care unit for the critically ill patient. It is coming under one of the monitoring system in the ICU. And it works on the principle of plethysmography. What is endotracheal tube? ETT. So in case of the emergency, the endotracheal tube has to be inserted into the respiratory tract in your trachea. And you need to see to that the endotracheal tube should not go beyond the carina. Otherwise, it may go into the right side of the lung. And then if you connect with the ventilator, then what will happen? All the oxygenated air will go into the right side of the lung. So right side there will be hyperoxygenation, and it is a non-properly placed ETT. So in emergency it has to be inserted. It is easier to insert and it is less comfortable for the patient and may cause the gag reflex. You need to remember that in the adult the ET tube is having an inflating balloon, whereas in pediatric and infants it does not have the inflating balloon. What is tracheostomy tube? Okay, to insert the tracheostomy tube, the tracheostomy surgical part is surgery is to be performed through the anterior tracheal wall, and it is performed usually to prevent or to treat the long-term respiratory failure. And it decreases the anatomic dead space by 50%, so it reduces the work of the breathing. It is used for the protection of the airway from the aspiration, and it allows the oral intake and the good oral hygiene. So tracheostomy tube is to be inserted in the patient who needs long term of the mechanical ventilation, maybe say through the ventilator. So you can have the insertion of the tracheostomy tube into this group of patient. What is Ryle's tube? Nasogastric tube, that is the another name for the same. So it is a narrow bore tube which is inserted through the nose, past the throat and down into the stomach, and it is used for the nutritional support. It is used for administration of the drugs and the other oral agent, also used for the aspiration of the stomach contained. So from the nose it is introduced, it has been kept inside the patient's stomach. And before insertion, a local anesthetic gel lignocaine is applied on that, and then once it is inside, okay, you can check it with the help of x-ray, or you can insert the water and you can keep the stethoscope on the stomach and you can listen for the bubbling sound, and through that you can make it out that it is correctly placed into the stomach. So it is also used for the aspiration of the stomach contents. So in case of the food poisoning, if you want to take out the content from the stomach, so after inserting the Ryle's tube, you can create the negative pressure and the content of the food can be taken out and it can be sent for the laboratory investigation. What is Guadal airway? Okay, it is also known as the oropharyngeal airway. It is made up of rubber, metal, and most commonly it is made up of plastic. Once you are inserting in the mouth, okay, it lies between the posterior pharynx and the tongue and it pushes the tongue forward. It will activate the gag reflex and it should use on the unconscious patient. And correct sizing of the airway is imperative. And even the patient who is having a tendency to bite the suctioning catheter, so in those patients you can use the Guadal airway so that they cannot bite the suctioning catheter, and you can insert the suctioning catheter from the hole of the Guadal airway. What is defibrillator? So defibrillator are of two different types. The one which we see in the ICU and in the hospital, which is battery operated, and you must have seen it is kept on the charging. That is the first device. So while using that device, you need to apply the electroconductive gel and you need to give the cardioversion on the patient's chest. And another one is your AED, that is automated external defibrillator, which we see most commonly in the EMS, that means emergency medical service, 108 in India, 911 in US, and number 9 or any code in the hospital you can activate for the EMS. So at that time they use the AED. So AED has an advantage that it analyzes the rhythm of the patient's electrical activity of the heart, and at the same time after the analysis you can give the cardioversion, that means the cardiac shock as well. So it is the most commonly used for the treatment for the life-threatening cardiac dysarrhythmia, ventricular fibrillation, and it consists of delivering a therapeutic dose of electrical energy to the heart with a device called a defibrillator, and it allows the normal sinus rhythm to be re-established. And nowadays on many of the public places like the railway station and on the airport, you found that the defibrillator device is available, and many people are trained how to use this device. Now what is humidifier? Okay, so humidification is the moistening of the air or gas what we breathe, and there are two types of humidifier: supplier of water and conserver of water. Now when you are delivering the low flow oxygen to the patient through the humidifier device, you need to see to that the chamber of the humidifier is filled up with the water, so that you are not delivering the dry oxygen. If you are delivering the dry oxygen, the secretion which is present in the patient's chest may become dry and there may be the crust formation. So later on it is very difficult to remove those secretion. So you need to see that you are delivering the moist air into the patient's respiratory tract. So indication is whenever the patient is on oxygen therapy, because the oxygen leads to the drying of the respiratory passages, dehydration and thickness of the mucosa, so you need to deliver the humidified oxygen. When the secretions are abnormally thick, you can humidify, and when the patient is on artificial airway, you need to do the humidification. What is nebulizer? So to deliver the aerosol therapy, to deliver the drug, the nebulizer device is most commonly used by the physiotherapist, and in the form of a mist inhaled into the lungs. It uses the oxygen, compressed air or ultrasonic power to break up the medical solutions and suspensions into the small aerosol droplets that can be directly inhaled from the mouthpiece of the device. Mainly there are two types of nebulizer: jet nebulizer and ultrasonic nebulizer. Jet nebulizer works on the Venturi principle, and ultrasonic nebulizer works on the piezoelectric effect. And what is ICU monitoring? So ICU monitoring, in that we do monitoring of so many different parameters on the patient. So patient monitoring, that is the most appropriate term. So we monitor the temperature, we monitor the ECG, we monitor pulse oximeter, we monitor arterial blood pressure, we monitor different hematological and biochemistry investigative parameters like your CBC, ESR, blood glucose, routine urine examination, lipid profile, etc., etc. Central venous pressure, CVP, pulmonary artery occlusive pressure, cardiac output and hemodynamic variables, and ICP, intracranial pressure. So thank you very much for watching the